please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
Well, there you have it. It's cut across.
I'll share with you our results from the first quarter of fiscal 2019. We are delighted that our strategic focus on scaling agile digital and energizing our core services with automation and AI is resonating strongly with our clients, as also is our approach to enhance the skills of our employees and our actions on localization in the markets we operate in. Our digital revenue has grown by 25% year-on-year in constant currency to reach $813 million for the quarter, which is a quarter-on-quarter growth of 8%, again in constant currency. Our total digital revenue is at 28% of our business. Our overall revenue has grown by 6% year-on-year and 2.3% quarter-on-quarter in constant currency. Our operating margin was at 23.7%. We had $1.1 billion of large deals in Q1, of which 40% were in financial services. And we had an increase by 4 clients to a total of 24 clients that are now over $100 million revenue in a trailing 12-month basis. Overall, we see a good demand environment across the US, Europe, and Asia Pacific. In terms of sector demand, we see strength in energy, utilities, retail, insurance, and manufacturing. In our agile digital business, we see especially strong traction for the work we're doing in cloud, in data and analytics, in IoT, and in the area of experience. Our two recent acquisitions, Brilliant Basics in the UK and Wong Doody in the US, are helping us expand our portfolio in the experience area and already starting to have an impact across our client base. We see continuing traction of our automation approach and our artificial intelligence platform NIA within our core services business. Our approach to progressively move our employees onto an agile platform is seeing good traction. In our localization program, we've launched a new 75-acre campus in Indiana in the US and are now planning 4 other locations in the US, 6 in Europe, and 3 in Australia. With a strong foundation of delivery, the focus on agile digital and AI-powered core services, we are now expanding our strong sales and go-to-market teams. With that, I feel we have a stable start to the year and are executing on our strategy and our 3-year transformation program. Let me now hand you over to Praveen, our COO.
No, I think we get into questions.
Good afternoon. We had a very broad-based financial performance on multiple fronts. Let me talk about some of the few key financial indicators. First of all, the operating margin. I'm happy to inform you that it is at 23.7%, pretty much near the higher end of the guidance that we gave in the beginning of the year, which was 22 to 24%. Our return on equity expanded and it crossed 25% at 25.5%. It's a high in several years. It was primarily an account of an efficient capital management, including the capital allocation policy that the company successfully executed during the year. Third, our free cash flow jumped over 30% sequentially to $550 million. That's very healthy. Fourth, of course, the EPS grew year on year 3.9%. And one of the key indicators that we watch as we execute our digital journey is really the per capita revenue, that is revenue per employee, that further increased for 12 quarters in a row on the back of productivity improvements, automation, and also larger share of digital services. During the quarter, as part of the capital allocation policy, we declared the final dividend. It was paid off to investors, and it amounted to 70% of the free cash flow as per the capital allocation policy. And as you know, as per the new policy that was announced in April 2018, special dividend of $400 million was paid out, and an additional $1.6 billion was identified by the board to be distributed for fiscal 19 in a method and a manner to be decided by the board. So overall, we had on multiple fronts a very broad-based financial performance.
Thank you very much for that. My name is Fatima Karan, and I'm from Business Television India. I would like to show off about the fact that I've gotten the luckiest first draw in terms of questions. Thank you for what you've just told us. The key question really, I think, just really expands on what you've said behind those numbers, which is basically you've maintained your guidance, and investors and analysts will be looking at the fact that there has not been an upward revision, so to speak. Your numbers, of course, are stable. So what exactly are you predicting in terms of your trajectory when it goes, if one was to describe it? I mean, the question would be, is there some kind of uncertainty that you're projecting there, or what is the what is it that you're telling us? And secondly, of course, yours is, of course, very much a cash-generating company. Buybacks would be something that would be an obvious choice. A bonus, of course, is mainly something that's used for the balance sheet. So just give us a little more in terms of what you have, you know, what you've announced there, and how would you like to explain it?
Yeah, on the clearly the revenue and the margin guidance, I hope you're looking at the both. Let me look at the operating margin guidance. We gave at the beginning of the year 22% to 24%, and we also said, you know, we'll be making certain gradual investments to leverage digital opportunities, and we have even made that. So the first quarter, we closed at 23.7, pretty much near the higher end of our guidance. And during the year, of course, we'll continue to focus on both the operational efficiencies as well as the investments that we need to make hand in hand. Coming to the revenue guidance, we stated in the beginning of the year 6% to 8% in constant currency, and it was based on the visibility and the momentum that we saw both in terms of the pipeline as well as multiple sectoral the trajectory that we see, and we have delivered 2.3%, and on year on year it is 6% in constant currency, and we'll continue to reiterate our guidance in 6% to 8%. Of course, the deal wins, after 7 quarters, it has crossed $1 billion, which again, 40% is financial services. We continue to kind of execute our strategy during the course of the year. Let's see one more quarter and how it goes, and we'll continue to focus on that. Coming back to the capital allocation policy, as you know, last year, including the buyback of $2 billion, we returned $3.7 billion back to the shareholders. And this year again, the board has approved up to 70% free cash flow to be returned, and additionally $2 billion to be returned to the shareholders, over and above 70%, of which out of the $2 billion, $400 million we have already paid back in June by way of a special dividend. Balance $1.6 billion we'll be looking at returning in a method and mechanism to be decided by the board.
Hi, I'm Jessica Saxon from NBC TV18. Now, my first question to Salil. Salil, the financial services business has been a bit of a concern across the industry. This time around, the growth is flattish on a constant currency basis. What is your view in terms of the uptick that you're seeing? Are you expecting a rebound in the financial services vertical anytime soon? If yes, can you give us a timeline? And of the $1 billion large deal, when you say 40% is from financial services, so will we see that traction coming in by the second quarter? And I'll ask the other questions one by one.
I think our financial services business sees a very strong demand today. In dealing with the large deals, 40% of our large deals wins have come from financial services. Those naturally will transition into revenue-generating businesses for us over the course of the next few quarters. In many of the areas, for example, in our core services, in digital, in specialized areas within financial services, we see good traction. We see good traction now again starting to come in the U.S. marketplace within the banking and the insurance business. And especially in the insurance area, we see strong activity. So our outlook on financial services remains positive, and we see that is something that is a foundation we are driving
in. In the coming quarter, you are
We are seeing a strong demand, yeah, absolutely.
Okay. Ranga, as far as your margins are concerned, the fact of the matter is that there is weakness in the rupee. Are you confident that you will be able to stay at the higher end of the guidance through the year? Any chance of revision mid-quarter? And another clarification that I wanted was the Panaya fair value has reduced by about 270 crore rupees. So last quarter you had taken an impairment charge of 118 crore. Could you clarify on that point?
Sure. Coming to the margin, as I said, we indicated the band of 22 to 24. Yes, in the first quarter, we are at 23.7. Yes, rupee did benefit. At the same time, we also rolled out the compensation hikes, and we also had certain investments as we had outlined. I think it takes into account all those factors. And the fact that in the balance three quarters, we continue to focus on operational efficiency as well as the investments hand in hand. If you look at this quarter, it was not just the rupee. Rupee was, of course, one element. If you look at the utilization as well as the on-site mix, that itself gave us 40 basis points advantage. In addition, of course, the rupee, about 100 basis points. And at the same time, compensation of 100 basis points totally kind of negated the rupee impact. So overall, I think the margin, operating margin of 23.7 first quarter is a reflection of both investments as well as the operational efficiency pieces that we have done. Of course, the investments are gradually in nature, as we outlined in the beginning. In the balance three quarters, we will gradually make those investments to leverage the opportunities clearly there. Coming to the Panaya, as you know, in March 2018, based on the strategic review of our entire portfolio, we had identified that in case of both Panaya and Scava, we would explore sale, and we started negotiations during this quarter. Based on the progress that we have made at this juncture, based on our judgment at this stage, we have taken a reduction in fair value by $39 million. And the negotiation is still in progress. I think we will have to continue that negotiations. Broadly, that's it. And the impact on net profit was $39 million on account of Panaya fair value write-down. In rupees, it was 270 crores.
Okay, last question to Praveen. Praveen, the attrition has gone up this time. Utilization is at an all-time high, yes. But what are you doing to bring down attrition? Is the utilization rate maintainable? By how much can you bring down the attrition? And also, I believe there has been a reorganization in the segmental reporting this time around. What's the reason for that?
Okay, on the attrition, this quarter attrition is slightly higher at 20.6 as compared to the previous quarter. Part of it is seasonal, because in quarter one you typically have a big percentage of people going abroad for higher education. Nevertheless, it's probably higher than what we have seen in the past. We have identified what are the areas. Big chunk of attrition has come in people with experience from 2 to 4 years. So we have identified some specific interventions we will do to bring the attrition down. We are confident that over the next 2-3 quarters, we should be able to bring it down to manageable proportions.
Yeah, as you know, we have adopted IFRS 15, which is a new revenue accounting standard. Ind AS also has a corresponding standard. It is effective from January 2018, since our financial year began in April. This is the first quarter we adopted. There are certain additional disclosure requirements required under IFRS 15. So in line with that, we have restructured the segment reporting, and there are certain additional disclosures that we need to make, which we have disclosed.
Hi, Chandra Srikant from ET Now. Sari, my first question to you. You had mentioned a couple of months back, Aripis, that it's time to sacrifice margins and start investing in new technologies. How are you going to do that, when you're maintaining your operating margin guidance within the same 22 to 24% band? And when you talk about investments, do you mean acquisitions perhaps in the digital space? That's something that Accenture has done quite successfully. Will we see moves like that, or has the Panaya experience sort of made you a little more cautious when it comes to acquisitions? If you can just clarify on that.
Sure. I think our approach is really, as we've seen with our clients, there's a huge shift to what they're doing in the digital space. There, we've been quite careful to identify areas of growth, for example, cloud, data and analytics, user experience, and we see a lot of traction in that. Our approach is really to put focus, attention and investment into those areas and scale them up. So it's not a question of sacrificing margin. Really, we have a strong operating business, and it's more a question of making sure that we build a business for the future. So with the guidance that we shared at the start of the year, we're well within and actually comfortable in that guidance, and that's the approach we've taken to our business. In terms of acquisitions, as you know, we made the acquisition of Wong Doody just a few months ago, and that's an indication that we are actually looking at and quite open to where it makes sense and where it enhances what we do with our clients to look at acquisitions. So that's an ongoing approach for us.
Ranga, despite the positive commentary from Salil, why have you sort of stopped short of raising the guidance number, is it taking into account, risks on the currency front, or do you expect, some pressure in Q2, Q3? And secondly, utilization is at a record high, 85.7. That was your lever for the last many quarters. So what lever is going to make up for this? Is there further headroom?
Well, I think as we have been consistently saying, there are multiple aspects to the margin guidance, right? We get 22 to 24, first quarter, yes, we are very good at 23.7 in the top quartile. And we've also said that we'll continue to make gradual investments during the quarter, which we had highlighted, whether it is in a US talent model, whether it is in repurposing the talent. Third one is on the digital as well as the sales revitalizations. They are gradual investments. We'll calibrate them and we continue to make as for they are leveraging the digital opportunities. Yes, utilization is high. I think every time, every quarter we say nearly high, it's very little leg room, and again it went up by 1%. But having said that, yes, the runway is limited. I think if you look at the on-site mix, which used to be 30% 1 year ago, is almost down to 28.6%. That is one. Most importantly, we are looking at the productivity-led and the automation-led improvements in certain service lines which are more amenable for automation, which has also helped us in increasing the revenue per employee, right? And if you look at the on-site cost as a percentage of revenue has further come down this quarter, primarily because in the on-site we have looked at a combination of in fixed-price projects, looking optimizing the pyramid structure to some amount of localization and further enhanced productivity in on-site. Because these are the elements which have really helped us in achieving the margin. At the same time, we are comfortable with the guidance and we'll continue to make investments at the same time, leverage all the levers that we have.
Finally, Praveen, you've been talking about this $1 billion target in terms of deal wins, and you finally crossed that number. Is it sustainable? Is this a number that we are going to see in the coming quarters as well? Or, was there some one-off this quarter that finally helped you cross the $1 billion mark in terms of deal wins?
If you notice, our trajectory has been gradually increasing over the last several quarters. And as you said, we are really happy it has crossed that $1 billion mark. The pipeline is very healthy. We still have a large number of deals. But unfortunately, in large deal kind of situations, we have no control over when the deal is likely to close. Sometimes some of the closure will shift from one quarter to the other. Our hope is that we'll continue to maintain this. Almost all the deals that we have won has an element of digital in it, because most of the deals, even if it is from a legacy, it involves modernization and replatforming and so on, migration to cloud, and there is always a part of digital in increasing part of digital in this large deal wins as well.
Good evening, gentlemen. Sadith here from Bloomberg Quint. Salil, you began your commentary by saying you see a good demand environment, and then you came out with a guidance which is 6-8% in constant currency term, which is retaining the same one which you did at the beginning of the year. What are the factors which is preventing you from upping your guidance, given that you see a robust demand coming in? Secondly, I want your commentary on the financial services sector, how it's been doing. Do you see American BFSI segment going coming back into play? Because we saw that one with one of your competitors where, BFSI was doing really well. They said that it's not green shoots, it's really picking up. And when I see your financial services numbers on a quarter-to-quarter basis and on constant currency terms, it has fallen. So what is that divergence which is coming between you and your competitor? And for Ranga, I'll come back to.
It's a long list pending.
On the demand environment, I think my comment is more in the interactions I'm having with clients, our sales teams are having with clients, how we see the activity, whether it's on agile, digital, on core services. Overall, across geographies and several of the sectors, we see a stable to good demand environment. Now, the guidance discussion is a different discussion. I think we have a good start, a solid start to the first quarter. As Ranga said, we will now execute on Q2, Q3, and for the full year. And as that progresses and as the demand we see translating into what we can convert, we will see how that plays out. So we don't have any real need to make any adjustments. The comment was more about seeing this from a client perspective. On banking, you know, what's interesting is I was in a client session 2 weeks ago. We were looking at a digital bank for a U.S. client. What we have built for them has been so transformational in how they're approaching their market that you start to see that there is spend coming into that area. I was in another client discussion where they're looking at what Praveen mentioned, the cloud migration and modernization, again with a banking CIO. So when you see that sort of scale activity, whether it's a digital bank creation where our platform is really driving it, you know, Finacle is the prime driver for that across the world, or you see this sort of change from a cloud modernization perspective, that gives us confidence that the environment is solid, our client base is reflecting that, and they see that we have the capability set to drive that. And now we're starting to execute on that. So I have a view that gives me positive feeling about how that sector is going to evolve.
Ranga, to begin with, if you can elaborate, what was the dollar guidance? You've given a constant currency guidance, what's the dollar guidance? And then on the operating margins front, though you have guided between 22 to 24 and you are nearly at the upper end, from a quarter to quarter basis, Q4 to Q1, you have nearly 100 bips decline in your operating margins. If you can break it up, where it comes from, what is the impact of cross-currency headwinds or tailwinds which you see going forward?
Sure. Let me start with the operating margin question. Yes, sequentially 100 basis points decline, of which, let me give the breakup. We had a rupee benefit net of cross currency impact was about 100 basis points positive, which was entirely offset by the compensation that we rolled out effective April to over 85% of our employees. Then we had, because of the higher utilization and on-site mix moderation, we had a benefit of 40 basis points. Then again, higher investments and some into both sales as well as G&A, as well as some of the subcontractor additional expenses that we had to make had a negative impact of 140. So net is 100. So I think, as I said in the beginning, we guided for 22 to 24. In the first quarter, we are at the top quartile, and we continue to make the investments gradually over the course of Q2, Q3, Q4, at the same time optimizing some of the parameters and levers that I talked about earlier. So that's where we are. We are comfortable in this band. Coming to the constant currency guidance, we reiterate at 6-8%. And for some of the currency parameters, it's disclosed in the fact sheet. I can walk you through after this telecast.
Ranga, final one on cash and cash utilization. You've been telling us that you have spent $1.6 billion or give it back to shareholders. When do we see concrete announcements on that? And for Praveen, what is the kind of guidance you have for employee addition for FY19 going forward? You saw some bit of increase in attrition there. How are you seeing that?
So coming back to the 1.6 billion, first of all, let me assure you we are not going to spend 1.6 billion. We are going to return to the shareholders. And yeah, so the capital allocation policy that was approved by the board in April had two components. One is return up to 70% of the free cash flow to the investors. We started executing that already. Additionally, the board had identified $2 billion to be returned to the shareholders for fiscal 19, of which $400 million we have already returned in June by way of special dividend. The balance $1.6 billion will be returning to the shareholders in a method that will be approved by the board, and we will announce that in due course.